Nance, I debated about whether or not to send this in, because my story isn't something that's easy for me to tell. When I do, I start feeling all of the things I felt the day that it happened, and none of those things are good. I heard you say the other week about how you thought not all Sasquatch were good or bad, that they might be just like people, and maybe they're bad if they have young ones around. But I ran up on one in another situation that I would say definitely makes them a serious threat. I'm here to tell everyone that Sasquatch are not salad munchers. They are definitely predatory meat eaters, and I do not doubt that they would not hesitate to eat a human. I don't imagine that we look any different to them than any other animal they run across. I was in the Grand Teton National Park in 2008. I'd hiked up to Grand Viewpoint. Below and spread out to the east are two lakes. I forget their names. Anyway, I decided to hike down the middle piece of land between the two lakes. Mostly, I wanted away from an annoying family that had a bunch of kids. No matter how much I tried, we kept getting bunched up together on the trail. Kind of like how in the grocery store, where no matter how much you try, you keep getting stuck in the same aisle over and over with the most annoying, slow-walking person in the whole store. Even if you skip a few aisles, you turn the corner to find them right there again. Yeah, that's how it was with me and that family with annoying kids. Those kids were annoying AF. Anyway, there's a good mix of timbers and open areas through the land between those lakes. I had been through this area many years before, and if I remembered right, I knew that if I cut off to the left, I would head down toward the northern of the most of the two lakes. It was afternoon, about 2 o'clock. This was also in July. I was walking through a patch of timber. There was a lot of down timber throughout that area, I should add. Ahead, I could see the brightness that lit up one of the open areas between the big runs of timber. I slowed down when I was within 100 or 120 feet or so from the edge of the timber line. Something caught my eye. There against the brightness, I saw something dark at my 2 o'clock position. I stopped to be sure what I was seeing. When I first saw the profile, I thought I was looking at a bear that was leaning up against a piece of that down timber. There was a slope of shoulder and a massive girth that I took to be a bear's fat bottom. But then I saw the clear definition of legs, and legs that had knees, and they were bent because it was sitting on that piece of down timber. I could not see ears or a long snout or paws. The timber it was sitting on was at an angle to my position, so it was sitting at an angle that made its profile and its movements easy to see against the brightness that backlit the area beyond where it sat. Now, the lack of a snout and paws were what I noticed missing first, and for a very unsettling reason. The creature was holding something in its lap, and from the side profile of it sitting there, I watched, and I could see clearly that it was digging into whatever it was holding, and then lifting something to its mouth. I stood there puzzled for maybe 5 or 10 seconds, just watching it make the repeated motion of dipping down to that thing in its lap, and then bringing its hand, yes, a hand, not a paw, up to its mouth. I was very confused, but it was clearly eating something. But as much as my eyes were telling me what I was seeing, I was having a really hard time with it. I was blanking out. I couldn't connect the dots on what I was seeing. Then it lifted the thing from its lap and began to tip it towards its mouth. And all I could think of is it looked exactly like how my kids drink the last bit of milk out of their cereal bowl. Then I could see that what it was holding and what had been in its lap and what it had tipped towards its mouth was some kind of animal's head, or skull to be exact. There was an elongated snout on the skull that I could see against the outline from the sun behind it. There was no lower jaw to the head, and it might have still had fur on it, I'm not sure. It didn't look white, but I was certain that I saw teeth. But it was crystal clear to me that it was holding a skull. Now suddenly, all those dots that I couldn't connect before suddenly started connecting themselves, and I did not like the picture they were making. Somehow, I had walked right up on a Sasquatch eating a kill. How it hadn't heard me, I don't know. I guess it was more focused on eating, or maybe it couldn't hear anything beyond the sounds it was making eating. I don't know. But I did know that one of the most dangerous places you can ever find yourself is near a predatory animal that is eating its kill. And that's right where I was. And I knew I needed to get out of there. And I couldn't think of anything beyond that. I had to get out of that area, and before my brain could really instruct my feet on what to do, my feet started moving on their own, and I was trying to walk backwards without looking where I was going. I just couldn't bring myself to take my eyes off of what I was seeing ahead of me. I also vaguely was aware that I had a fear that if I turned to look at where I was going behind me, that when I turned back around, that thing would be right there in front of me like some horror movie. Anyway, without thinking, I took a few steps backwards, and then I stepped on a limb or something that made a cracking, loud, snapping sound. Oh boy, now it knew I was there. I had its attention. In horror, I watched as it quickly stood up and turned in my direction. Saying that I was scared at that moment was like saying the ocean is a little bit wet. I was terrified beyond words. I still have not found the right words after all this time to say what I felt in that moment. When it stood up, it had an aggressive and predatory posture. I can't tell you any better than that. If you've ever been in a predatory animal's focus, I don't have to explain it to you. If you've never been the focus of a predatory animal's gaze, I can't possibly explain it to you. I can only say that I could feel the danger and the malice emanating from that creature from that distance. And even that just doesn't do it justice. Now I know that wisdom says not to run, not to look like prey, don't trigger that chasing instinct from a predatory animal. But in my panic, I couldn't stop myself. I ran faster and longer than I think I ever have in my adult life. It's a wonder I didn't knock myself out running headlong into a tree. I was so scared, I kept looking back every half second or so. My fear really grew when I looked back and I no longer saw the creature where it had been. I was looking wildly around, but I didn't see it coming up behind me, so I kept running, even though I didn't know where it went. Eventually, I found myself right back on the trail that I had left earlier, and I hightailed it all the way out as fast as I could. I don't think that creature followed me at all, or if it did, it didn't follow me far. Here are my thoughts on what happened, Nance. First, it is definitely a meat eater, and there was something in that posture when it stood up, when it knew I was there, that makes me absolutely certain that humans are on its menu. The best I can tell you is when it turned to look at me, it might as well have been a hungry lion looking at me. No, I wasn't close enough to see its facial expression, but I know to trust my gut feelings, and I'm telling you that it was sizing me up to maybe be the next snack on the menu. Second, I'm actually surprised that the creature didn't follow me. I believe it could have easily caught me with no effort if it had wanted to, and I don't know why it didn't. Maybe I didn't smell so good after I'd been out hiking and sweating all day. Maybe it was just satisfied with the kill it already had. I don't know. Third, I don't know where the rest of the animal that it had killed and was eating. I don't know what kind of animal it was. If I had to take a guess, it was maybe a coyote or a fox or a small deer. Maybe something about that size. Fourth, no clue on what it looked like. The whole thing, as I said, was backlit with sunlight from out in the open area beyond. I was mostly seeing outline and shadow. I do not even know exactly what color the Sasquatch was. And I do know it was a Sasquatch. I am sure of that. When it stood up, it was a solid 8 feet tall, I would say. There isn't a linebacker in the NFL that could compare with its torso mass. Never mind its height. Oddly, I don't remember much about its legs. I think I was so focused on the upper body that when it stood up, I couldn't see the legs. And yeah, it did have a pointy head. I did see all the things that I know everyone who is listening to this right now about the part where I was trying to figure out what I was seeing. I know what you're thinking. You were saying to yourself, "You dumbass, it's a Sasquatch, it's a Bigfoot." But that wasn't how it happens when you see one. At least, it didn't with me. In closing, I'm just going to say that all of you can go ahead and take your oranges and bags of marshmallows out and leave gifts or whatever for those things if you want. But you're crazy if you do. Don't encourage them. Maybe the females aren't so aggressive, you know, like Patty in that film. I don't know. But I wouldn't bet my life on a big male. My whole encounter might have lasted a half minute, maybe even less, starting from when I first saw it until I began to reflexively run. And I can't help but think that there were many variables and many seconds along the way of that encounter where it all could have gone a different way. And it could have been my skull that Sasquatch was digging its fingers into later that day. But I made it out. And I have to say, I haven't been back in hiking for a while. And when I do, I never go alone. And I will never go alone again. Please don't even use my first name. Just call me Not a Squatch Snack. My name is Dwayne, and I was born in New Brunswick, Canada, and raised in Aroostook County, Maine. My mom, whose experience this is, was also born in New Brunswick and was raised in the small northern Maine border town of Van Buren. I have been listening to your videos and all the encounters people have submitted, and occasionally I get my mom and dad to listen as well. I have always been a believer, though I've never had an encounter. Growing up, I just didn't think Bigfoot lived in Maine or eastern Canada. But having listened to encounters on YouTube and checking out the BFRO website, I have recently discovered that Bigfoot does indeed haunt the woods of Maine and New Brunswick, Canada. So back to the story. My mom, who had been listening to a few encounter stories with me, recently remembered an event that happened to her as a 10-year-old girl. In 1965, she and her older sister Marie, her older brother Richard, along with her younger brothers Stephen and John, had decided that they would go into the woods one summer's day to cut some small pine trees and bring them home to hide an ugly fence on the rental property they lived on. While in the woods, my mom grew tired and wanted to cool her feet in the stream nearby. She told her siblings her plans, and they agreed. They left her alone by the stream to continue cutting down small pine trees. As she was sitting and splashing in the water, my mother says that a small rock came out of the woods and landed near her. She looked around and saw no one. It happened a couple of more times, and she cried out, "You guys stop throwing rocks at me," thinking it was her little brothers who were being mischievous. There was no response, so she continued to rest and cool her feet in the water. Then a large rock came flying out of the woods and splashed into the water very close to her. Now my mom was surprised and angry, thinking her little brothers were still up to their mischief. She yelled out for them to stop throwing rocks, but once more heard only silence. Soon thereafter, her siblings came to collect her and asked her who she was yelling at. She said it was them she was yelling at and that they had been throwing rocks at her. They all denied throwing rocks and accused her of lying. My mom asked them, "Then who was throwing rocks at me?" They said they didn't know, that maybe it could have been a hobo, because no one in Van Buren at that time knew anything about Bigfoot. All the way back home, my mother continued to accuse her little brothers of throwing rocks at her, but they denied it adamantly. After having listened to some encounter stories with me and hearing how Bigfoot likes to throw rocks at people, her memory of this event was triggered. I said, "It could have been a homeless person. It could have been your little brothers, too, though they never admitted to it. But it also could very well have been a Bigfoot. After all, northern Maine is very rural, and it could be a very good place for a Bigfoot to live. Well, Nance, I hope this story is interesting enough for you. I know it's not a definite sighting, but it's not impossible that it was a Bigfoot either. Thanks, Dwayne." This isn't your typical Sasquatch encounter, but I thought you might enjoy it. I prefer to remain anonymous. This happened in 1974 or 75. There wasn't any internet, so any news of Bigfoot never reached the big Midwestern city where I lived. I met up with a couple of friends for a camping trip to the south side of Beaver Lake in northern Arkansas. One of my buddies had gathered some supposedly edible wild plants that we cooked and ate, and it didn't agree with me, and I started making numerous trips to our makeshift latrine. We had placed our latrine in an area with a bunch of grape vines which have large, soft, and non-irritating leaves and make great toilet paper. We found a log and notched out a V with a hatchet for a makeshift toilet seat, and rolled it between two big bushes by the grapevines. There was a rock cliff at the back and two bushes on either side, so our crapper was concealed on three sides and the log was about halfway back. On one of my many trips to the log, I started hearing noises to my left, like something walking through the undergrowth. When it got across my position on the other side of the bush, it stopped. From my sitting position, I couldn't see what it was, but it startled me so bad that I unintentionally let one rip. The critter took off crashing through the trees like a runaway freight train. I only saw a glimpse of it, but it was big, brown, hairy, and fast. It didn't scare me because I wrote it off as an elk. Remember, I'm a city slicker, so I was ignorant of the animal life in the woods, and it was many years later when I discovered a website called The History of Elk in Arkansas, and that all the elk had been hunted out in Arkansas by the late 1800s. They reintroduced 200 Rocky Mountain elks in the early 1930s, but several years later a survey found no surviving elk. The Great Depression was in full swing, and even though it was illegal to hunt them, it was meat on the table for the locals, and none of the original 200 had survived. It wasn't until the 1990s that elk was restocked, and today the elk are back in Arkansas with limited hunting. So apparently there were no elk in Arkansas during the 1970s when I had my encounter. After many years and more research, I discovered the many Bigfoot websites. I started coming across encounters that describe Bigfoot crashing through the forest when spooked. This triggered my memory of that camping trip to Arkansas, and further investigations revealed that there had been sightings of Bigfoot in Arkansas. Now I wonder what I saw. There was no screams, vocalization, tree knocking, or bad smells other than my fart. I saw only a glimpse of it, and it was too big to be a bear or a deer. So what the hell did I see? I've never discussed this with anyone because to me, it was a non-event and I had almost put it out of my mind until YouTube came along. Good job. Thanks and be safe. My name is Mark. I'm from southern Vermont and I've been hiding a secret now for 25 years. I have never told anyone about what I saw on a youth hunt with my son and six of his friends and their fathers. It was a youth hunt for deer here in Vermont, and after a morning sit-in stand with my son, who was 12 at the time, we were going to meet up with our friends to do some deer drives for the kids. After we all had a bite to eat, we decided to do a drive at a place we called the Spike Horn Drive. We called it that because the first time we did the drive 2 years earlier, my friend's daughter shot a spike for her first deer. Let me give you the lay of the land. The property is shaped like a triangle. There are two dirt roads, one on each side of the property, and on the other side of the road there is a big apple orchard. I'm dropped off at the point where the two roads fork, and the others head down to the road to get set up. My friend Jeremy is with my son, so I'm the one who will walk through the woods towards them. All the kids are set up about 40 yards apart. When Jeremy calls me on the radio, I start walking towards them. I'm hoping the deer will be up on the flats feeding on beech nuts and white oaks. As I crest the top of the flats, I looked through my binoculars and spotted three deer feeding about 100 yards in front of me. I called Jeremy on the radio to have the kids get ready. I slowly started towards the deer. As I walked, they spotted me and ran toward the kids. I called on the radio to get ready. I suppose I should tell you, my son was using his new Browning A-Bolt Hunter 308, left-handed. This was the only gun I could find in left hand and compact enough for his small frame. It holds 5 shots. That will be relevant soon. As the deer ran towards the right, I figured the shooter set up close to the road would get the shot. All of a sudden, a shot rang out, then another, and another, and another. Then I heard someone else shouting. Then it was like a war zone with shots ringing out. As I took cover behind a tree, I looked to my left and saw something very large and dark behind a tree 60 yards in front of me. I thought it was a bear, but in all the commotion of the gunfire, it stood up and ran left out of my sight. I got on the radio and said, "Holy shit, you're not going to believe what I just saw." But just as I said it, it dawned on me. Don't say anything. I was thinking back to 3 years earlier when I told my friends I had seen a mountain lion or catamount, such as they are called in your neck of the woods. I was laughed at and heard all the jokes, you know, like, what was I smoking that night, or were you drunk and saw a bobcat? I'm sure you know what I'm talking about. So I decided to keep my mouth shut. I guess the critter was stalking the deer, too. But I guess we ruined his hunt. So as I walked up to the others, Jeremy started in with questions. He asked what I saw, but I didn't answer. As we all came together, Jeff, who was close to the road and saw the deer first, told the story. 5 deer in all were running towards him and his daughter. 4 does and a good buck. As the deer were at 40 yards, she shot. After the shot, the deer turned left and ran. Right as the deer ran the gauntlet 40 yards out in front of all the rest of the kids, I guess you can imagine the firestorm that started. 34 shots were fired. But no one hit a deer. Even though I was pretty excited about seeing the big fella, I wished I could have seen those 5 deer running the gauntlet. It must have been quite a sight to see. I named this story Running the Gauntlet because all I can picture it to is the Clint Eastwood movie when him and the girl are on a bus trying to get to City Hall and all the cops were shooting up the bus. I think the name of that movie was The Gauntlet. Well, I hope you liked my story. I'm sorry I'm not much of a writer. Keep up the good work. Thanks, Mark. Hi, Nance. This is a long and odd collection of things that have happened and that have led up to a single sighting. But we all think they're all connected. Let me know what you think, and if you think this is interesting enough to put on your channel, I hope so. We live near the Mohican River. Between our house and the river is about 1,000 feet of woods, give or take. My sister lives on the adjacent piece of acreage with her husband. All of us have children that are grown and moved out. I should add that our properties were once a single piece of land that was divided between me and her after our parents passed. So, we've lived on this land most of our lives, other than the period of adulthood when we lived elsewhere while our parents were still alive. In all these years, we've never seen or heard anything odd there. We know this land. We know the seasons, the wildlife, and the atmosphere here incredibly well. But in the summer of 2018, things we couldn't identify were happening. Let me back up. It actually started in the spring. The first thing that we noticed were the weird nights that started early that spring. They were unusually quiet. We didn't pick up on it right away, but soon we noticed that we didn't hear all the normal insect noises and all the other backfill noises that you usually hear at night near a river. It was too quiet. But it wasn't happening all the time, just some nights. Other nights were completely normal. But on one of those weird nights, me, my wife, my sister, and her husband were sitting around a fire ring out back. That's when we started to hear a sound that sounded like a big animal slowly and steadily making its way through the heavy woods near us. We were sitting maybe 350 to 400 feet away from the nearest trees in the middle of a cleared area. So we weren't afraid that something was going to reach out and grab us, but we all agreed there was something big moving out there. But we didn't have a guess as to what it might be. You know, when you live out in the more rural areas, you kind of learn to just accept a lot of what you hear, even if you can't see it, because more often than not, you hear and don't see. Now, my brother-in-law is an exceptional, experienced hunter. Now, I learned to hunt when I was younger, but I never got the taste for it that some men get. My brother-in-law had it, though, and he had not just the taste for it, but he had the knack of being skilled and successful at hunting. So we were all looking to him for a possible explanation of what that was out there. But he just sat there listening and looking out into the darkness. I could see he was puzzled. Once it had moved away, he kind of shook his head and turned back to us. I said, "So what do you think that was?" He said, "Man, I don't know, but it was walking on two legs." So that was one of the first things that happened. Over the next several weeks as spring went along, we had lots of odd things happen. Like one day my wife put clothes out on the clothesline late one afternoon, but she got busy and forgot to bring the laundry in that night. Now, she had done that before, and the worst thing that had ever happened was she found bird poop on some stuff in the morning. I think once we lost a shirt to the wind. But the next morning, that whole clothesline had been torn down. The laundry, most of which we could see was still pegged to the clothesline, was all trampled in the grass. When we got out there, it was clear that something had stomped all over the clothes. There weren't any clear footprints, but you could see that something had stomped around in the grass. Now, other things happened that were weird at that time, but we still didn't understand or put things together. Like, I had two large paper bags full of onion sets that we planned to put out in the garden. But sometime during the middle of the night, something took both of them off the back porch where I had left them. Bags and all were gone. Who would take onion sets, I thought, and all the way out here? If it had been an animal, I would have found the torn and chewed bags, and an animal wouldn't have probably taken both bags, or at least I didn't figure it would. It had never happened before. We did find a lot of things pulled up from the garden that spring and summer. Now, that isn't so unusual because there are lots of critters that attack the garden out there. But the amount of things going missing was much higher than most years. There were times we thought we heard something out in the trees, kind of like the first night. And then there were times that there were noises we couldn't explain. They were like a roar, but it wasn't a roar, and it wasn't a cry or a scream or a yell. It was closer to grunting exhales, and at other times it sounded more like a rattling, chesty vocalization that would carry all the way in through the open windows into the house. It didn't sound like it was trying to communicate, I don't think, but it was just out there making noise. Once we went out and we tried to find whatever it was, me and my brother-in-law. We went into the woods and we waited again for it to make the noise, but it never did. So we gave up that time. The next two times we heard it, we immediately went out there and tried to track it down and coordinate where we heard it. But each time, it went deadly silent when we stepped out into the trees. And then for a while, it seemed everything stopped as we headed into the summer. One night, me and my brother-in-law went down to the bank of the river to do some catfishing. We were night fishing and planned to spend the whole night out on the bank. We had done this many times over the years, so we were very comfortable doing this despite all the weird stuff that had been happening. But we didn't know what the cause of all that weirdness was. Eventually we would find out, though. We were fishing from a semi-clear and flat portion of the riverbank. It wasn't large, but it was enough for us to set up our poles. Now, we had alarms on our poles, so we were planning to just settle in and wait and maybe catch a nap here and there until the fish decided to bite. We were both in folding nylon camp chairs that had footrests that folded out. They were set up with a small table between us and a tiny battery-operated lantern on the table. That lantern gave off just enough light that we could see a foot or two all around us, but not beyond that. We weren't really getting any bites, it seemed, and at some point that evening, I think I dozed off, and he did too. The next thing I know, my brother-in-law was yelling. I opened my eyes, and I was trying to get up out of the camp chair, but that's like trying to get up out of a recliner while it's still fully extended. I was putting a leg over each side of the extended chair piece and was trying to push myself up out of the chair when I felt something push me and the chair over, and it came from behind my right shoulder. Now, I say pushed, but the truth is, it was more of a hard shove. I didn't have time to react. In all the tumbling I was doing, I caught sight of my brother-in-law's chair also overturned. Beyond that, I didn't get to see much. It was all a blur in the darkness. The small lantern had been knocked over and now rolled down the bank, leaving where I was in mostly darkness. In those maybe 2 or 3 seconds after we had been shoved, there was something right there with us on the riverbank. I have no doubt of it. I couldn't see it, but I did hear it. And there was that unmistakable feeling that there was something, that thing you get when something walks by you in the darkness. If the creature had had a smell to it, I didn't notice it, but I should add that the bank area of that river can sometimes be smelly on its own. I was shaken, and I didn't know what had just happened. I called out to my brother-in-law, and he was a few feet away from me. We got up close together, got the lantern, and we picked up our things and got ourselves together. I asked him, what the hell just happened? He said he didn't know. He said he woke up when he felt the chair moving like something had bumped it. But before he could react or do anything or come fully awake, he and the chair were being tossed and shoved forward and rolling over. And that's when he started yelling, and that's when I woke up. I asked him if he saw what it was. He said no. But even then, I realized that neither of us were saying, who was it, but what was it? There was nothing about that incident, Nance, that felt anything like a human prank or a wild animal that had come up on us. We both knew that whatever it was in the wooded area between us and our homes. We had come prepared to fish quite literally in our own backyard, so we weren't armed. We didn't discuss it, but going through the woods to get home wasn't happening in the darkness. We decided to wait it out until light, which was still a few hours away. All thoughts of catfishing had gone out of our heads, and when an alarm finally did go off on one of our poles, we both about jumped a mile into the air. Neither of us slept again that night. Once or twice, we heard something moving out there in the trees, but neither of us were going to go out to investigate inside the tree line. Now, after that night, we were much more aware of the woods and what could be out there. We spent more time outside at night, just listening for anything that might be out there, and we did hear what sounded like big things moving around out there quite often. And there would be sudden, loud wood snaps sometimes. My sister's cats also all went missing, all three of them, one after another, over a 2-week period. Now, I'm not saying that that's connected, but by that time, we were noticing anything and everything that happened out of the ordinary, and that happened during that time. And I should add, the youngest of those cats was 3 years old, and the oldest was 9 years old, so they knew their way around the area well. We went looking a lot through those woods, and we went armed, on and off, for the rest of the summer and well into the fall. I figured that maybe I would find some of those teepee structures or some kind of tree structure in general that I had been reading about on the internet. And yes, I had a suspicion by then, and we both were reading up on the internet, me and my brother-in-law. But we didn't find anything like what we had found online. We did, however, find a type of a trail that was clearly being made through our wooded areas that hadn't been there before. And it wasn't anything that we were making. The trail ran mostly parallel to the river, and it ranged about anywhere from 30 to 50 feet inside the trees measured from the riverbank. It went beyond our property in both directions. Now, we never found clear prints, but there were lots of indications that something big had been walking around. After that, we no longer went outside without firepower of some kind on us. I insisted that my wife wait to work in the garden until I got home from work every day. It was a lot later in the day than she normally worked out there, and she didn't like it. But I did not want her out there alone, that far from the house by herself, even though that's how she'd done it for years. After hearing me and her brother-in-law explain what happened the night we were catfishing, she finally agreed, though reluctantly. I never did see it, neither did my brother-in-law, neither did my wife. It was my sister who first and was the only one to see it. They had had a couple cords of wood delivered that day to stock up for the winter, as, obviously, none of us had been out in the woods taking timber down that year. The wood had been dumped, and she was stacking it up on the side of their metal shed. After stacking up an armload, she said she straightened up, and as she was turning around to walk back to where the rest of the wood was dumped, she suddenly made eye contact with it. She said she froze when she did so. She guessed that it had been there watching her, maybe for a while. At that point, she said she was about 40 feet from it, maybe 50 feet. It was just inside where the trees wrapped up around toward the shed and the house on that side. And as it was October, she was able to see it pretty clearly, since most of the foliage had died back in that area. She described it as being a muddy color. She said she would call it a mix of brown and gray. It was a color that blended in well with the surroundings, and she said the face was broad and heavily coated with fur or hair, except for around the eyes. And what she took to be skin on the face was a leathery gray color. She put it standing around 8 feet tall and said that the shoulders were very broad, and although most of the torso that she could see appeared to be muscular, it also tapered a bit. But she said that that was more of an overall impression than what she actually looked at, because her whole focus was on the face and eye area. She said she backed away slowly and that it didn't move, but it was watching her the whole time she did so. When she was close to the house, she turned and ran inside. When she got inside, she looked out from the window in the dining room, but it was gone. Of all of us, she is the only one that saw it. And if I hadn't already witnessed and experienced so many other weird things, I probably wouldn't have been very quick to believe her. But needless to say, I and the rest of us do believe her. And now when I think about that thing, about whatever it was that shoved us down on the bank, I am even less sure what to think, really. If it was a Bigfoot, I don't know why it did that. We weren't doing anything to draw attention to us. We weren't a threat to it. We didn't have any food out there with us. We just had some coffee in a thermos. It didn't make any sense, and it still doesn't. But it's the only thing that fits, and by that I mean it being a Bigfoot. We were thrown around by a Bigfoot, as preposterous as that sounds. And yes, it sounds preposterous even to me. But it's the only explanation I have. And it is preposterous, and that's why we haven't told anyone else. Now, I know others will say that it was just some teenagers that did all of this to us over the summer. But it just doesn't fit, and it doesn't answer all the questions or fit all the things that happened. There wasn't any more trouble the rest of that year. And we think that it moved on sometime over the winter. We had a couple deep snows in January, as I recall, but I do know that we went out looking every time we had snow. And there was never a sign of anything using the trail, and we found no prints anywhere. Spring 2019, and we listened and looked, and again found nothing. So that's it. There's been no activity or sounds since 2018. And that, Nance, is what happened to us, as God is my witness. If it wasn't a Bigfoot, I have no other explanation. And it would then mean that my sister is a liar. And again, as God is my witness, I have never known her to be such. Thanks for letting me tell this, but please, please keep my name out of it. Nance, I don't know if this will interest your listeners or not, as I didn't have a scary Sasquatch encounter. I had a Sasquatch encounter of the thirsty kind. When all of this happened, back in 1999, we were living somewhere either east or west of the corridor between West Union and Peebles, Ohio. I don't want to be too exact, as we still have family living there on the property. We bought the place in the early 1990s and settled in real good. We had good neighbors, but they weren't so close that they could look at you from their window or their front porch. We were all stretched out along a particular road with both some distance separating us, and there were also some finger-like stretches of woods coming up between most of the houses. Now, it's not that way today, however. Most of the trees have been cut back away from the houses, but not because of the Sasquatch. We weren't the first to know that something was going on. It was actually our closest neighbor to the left. I'm going to call him Daryl. Now, Daryl had a garden out back, but it wasn't the garden itself or vegetables missing that made him notice something was going on. It was the water valve that he had out there. Years before, Daryl had ran PVC piping out to the garden and had a freestanding spigot out there so he could water the garden, which was about 100 feet or more from the house, and that way he didn't have to wrestle several hundred feet of garden hose. It was the spigot, he noticed. Several days in a row in the previous week, he had gone out to the garden to find the tap running freely and the water spilling from the hose that was now partially uncoiled from the reel it was on, soaking part of the garden and leaving the other part dry. He didn't know what was happening, and he asked me if I'd had anything strange happening. Truthfully, I told him that I hadn't. Daryl was convinced that maybe a homeless person was living in the surrounding woods and was coming down for water. And if anyone who lived in Ohio in 1999 happens to recall, it was a very dry and very hot year. We hardly had any rain between April and October, as I recall. And I remember this well because everyone that I knew in that area was struggling to keep up with our gardens and to keep them watered. And no one had to cut grass that summer, because none of it was growing. The nearby creeks had all almost dried up, or were left with tiny stagnant puddles. So Daryl really was convinced that it was just someone needing water. And he said that he didn't care if it was someone that was needing the water. He would never deny any living creature water that needed it. But he said that he was going to put up a sign to ask them to please remember to turn off the water. Help yourself to the water and vegetables, but please turn off the water when you're done. The next time I talked to Daryl, he said the sign had done no good. They had just knocked down the stick with the sign on it, and repeatedly he was still finding the water left on. Seeing that we were now in a declared drought-affected area, and we weren't on public city water, the idea of water conservation was a real concern for us. Daryl said that he removed the spigot handle so you would need a pair of pliers to turn it on or off. A few days later, Daryl said that he went out the previous morning and found that the spigot and a length of PVC had been pulled up from the ground. The metal spigot stand was torn off the PVC end, presumably for whoever it was to get to the water. I said, "You mean they sawed through it, or they just unthreaded it from the pipe?" I asked because I wasn't sure how the spigot was attached to the PVC. He said, "No, they snapped it off. It was not a clean sawed edge. And the threaded portion where the connector fitted the spigot stand was still threaded to the spigot. It was snapped off inside the spigot." Now, that didn't sound right to me. A human couldn't possibly do that, and there weren't any animals around that could either. He told me he had since shut off the water going out to the garden and only turned it on when he planned to go out to water the garden. Additionally, he said he would leave a jug of water for whoever it was, but he really didn't appreciate them wasting water. Then, oddly, he cautioned me almost as an afterthought that I should be careful outside at night and told me to make sure my wife and kids knew that someone could be out there and to be really careful. So I go home and I tell my wife, because I hadn't mentioned any of the first things Daryl told me previously that had been happening. Not because I was trying to hide anything, Nance, but, you know, it was just that kind of a crazy day where I had talked to Daryl, then time had gone by between him telling me and me next seeing and talking to my wife, and there was a lot of other things going on, and I just forgot. I will just say that we had some family things going on that were more concerning and pressing for us at that time than a thirsty, homeless guy out in the woods. I told her what had happened over at Daryl's, but before I could tell her what Daryl thought it might be, she said, "I think there is someone living out there, you know. I think I saw them a week ago when I was leaving for work. They were out by the pit poking around." My wife was referring to the fire pit that we had out back. Now, we hadn't used it all summer because it was too dangerous with the drought, and it was just too darn hot even at night to build a fire. "What were they doing?" I asked her. She said, "I don't know. It just seemed like they were looking for something. They were just standing there. And when I saw them, I honked the horn, and they ran back to the woods. I meant to tell you, but I forgot by the time I got home that day." My wife was in her car on the side of the house where we had a gravel parking area at that time when she saw this. From there, she could see all the way back through the backyard to the woods that were out there. I left for work about 20 minutes before she did back then, so this would have put it at about 6:45 in the morning when she saw this. And while the sun was on its way up, the area out behind the house was still in shaded darkness. So she could see that something was moving out there, but she couldn't see it clearly. We now began to pay attention to things going on outside, where we really hadn't before. You see, both my wife and my daughter suffer from very bad allergies, so we never have the windows in the house open, no matter the time of the year or how nice the day is. And we didn't spend a lot of time outside as a rule because of this. And we certainly wouldn't have that summer due to the sweltering heat and high humidity. But I started to go sit on the back porch at night in the darkness. I just would sit and listen. I will be honest and tell you that my biggest fear at that time was that if there really was a homeless person living out there, that they would light a fire to cook something, and they could set the whole damn woods out there on fire. As I said, it was hot and dry that summer. One spark, and it would all be gone because everything was so dry. So that's part of what I was looking for as I was sitting out there. Any sign of a fire, some smoke, or something to tell me that someone was out there and approximately where they were. I had the idea that if I found them, I would offer them our small propane portable grill to cook with, and that I would buy them the small propane cylinders. I just didn't want any open fires out there. That was my fear. But I never saw anything on any of the nights that I sat out there. But I did start to hear things. Mostly, I was hearing strange, distant, pounding noises. There was no rhyme or reason to them. And once, I heard clearly something breaking and snapping out in the woods as it moved. I talked to Daryl several more times that summer and confirmed that he was hearing much the same thing. And that's pretty much how it stayed most of that summer. I later learned that Daryl was experiencing a lot more than he was telling me. But he didn't want to tell anyone because he was certain no one would believe him, and they probably wouldn't have. I believed him because I began to get a taste of it myself by August. It happened one night when I was awakened by my daughter, who is 8 years old. She came into our bedroom and said that someone was outside her bedroom window and they were getting water. It took me a second to wake up and understand what she was saying, but once I did, I jumped up out of bed. I realized that my daughter's bedroom was on the corner of the back of the house that had an outdoor spigot poking out of the cement foundation. It was almost right below her window. And once I made that realization, I told her and my wife, "Shh, to be quiet." And I listened, and sure enough, I could hear that weird whistling hum noise that the water makes flowing through the pipes inside the house whenever the outside spigots were turned on. I couldn't believe it. But I was still thinking it was a homeless person and taking pity on whoever it was during this awful drought. I thought, well, maybe Daryl had forgotten to put water out for them that day or something, and I decided to let them get the water, and then I'd figure something out tomorrow. I told my daughter to just sleep with us that night. But I laid there awake for probably an hour, and I could still hear the whistling hum that the water was still running. By now, I thought, whoever it was had surely gotten their water and left. I went into my daughter's bedroom just to be sure and looked down sideways from the window. I looked both ways. There was no one there. I decided to go out and shut the water off. I went out the back door. But as soon as I took the first step down the deck into the yard, I had a sudden feeling of unease. Suddenly I thought, what if the person isn't a homeless person? What if they're deranged or there's someone dangerous that maybe had escaped from somewhere that I didn't even know about? Suddenly, my mind was telling me that anyone who was hiding out in the woods was probably there for a reason and not a good one. But I needed to turn that water off. We could not waste it. I was only about 20 feet from the end of the house at that point. But for some reason, I just didn't want to walk forward. I don't have a better explanation than that. It must have been my sixth sense. I was standing on the last step, and I was facing the spigot on the end of the house. So the house was on my right, and the yard was on my left. Directly behind me on the left was the deck extension that ran perpendicular to where I stood. So I could look to my left and see the yard area, but anything further than that was obstructed by the deck. And that's where the Sasquatch was standing. I didn't know. I'm going to call it an it, because I don't know if it was male or female. I'm going to say that if it was a male, it was young, and I base that solely on the height. But I also think it would have been a young female as well, as it was not really any taller than me, and I'm 5'11". It was standing very still near where the deck ended out in the yard. I couldn't have seen it when I first walked out, unless I had been looking exactly that way, and even then it would have still been partially obscured by deck furniture in that corner. But it likely heard or saw me first. Before I realized that I was not alone, beyond the feeling of unease, I felt the hair raise up on my arms and my whole skin felt prickly. I believe that is part of that sixth sense warning. I had never had it so strongly before when I wasn't in an obviously sketchy situation where I knew I needed to be aware and on guard, so I was surprised when it happened while standing on my own property. It was a huffing noise that told me I wasn't out there alone. I didn't know if what was near me was a human or a wild animal of some kind. I couldn't see anything when I looked in that direction. But I knew the huffing noise I had heard had come from my left. I listened for a second and found that the huffing was followed by a clear sound of deep chest breathing. And that's what froze me. I was terrified, but I couldn't make my body move. And at that exact moment, the light on the back deck was flipped on, and a millisecond later, the rope lighting that ran under the deck railing underlit everything. My wife had heard me get out of bed and had followed me to see what was happening. When she couldn't see anything, she turned the light on to see. And she didn't see anything when the light came on. But I did. I could now clearly see a Sasquatch standing at the corner of the end of my deck, and that is to say, 15 feet away from me. The slanted, domed head was very visible, as the rope lighting lit it perfectly where it stood. And the rope light cast a lot of shadows, and the eye area was shadowed and dark, as if the eyes were sunk backwards deep in the head. Other than not being able to see its eyes clearly, I saw the rest of it clear enough to be certain it wasn't a human in a costume, and I couldn't be mistaking some homeless man who hadn't bathed or cut their hair in a long time. No, this was not an unkempt human. The pattern of fur was clearly seen, and what I could see in the light showed that the fur laid all in a downward direction from its head down. The fur pattern looked short, not shaggy or long, and it wasn't shiny under the light either, but it looked to be a reddish brown in the yellow light from the rope lights. I never saw its teeth, as its mouth never opened, and I can't say for sure what the shape or width of the mouth even was, because I couldn't see any obvious lip protrusions, and most of the face was covered in fur. The face that I could see was wide, and the whole head sat down low on its chest, kind of like a gorilla, but not like a gorilla. I knew that, even though I wasn't in the Pacific Northwest, and that what I saw was not standing 8 feet tall or higher, I knew I was looking at a Sasquatch. But I couldn't take my eyes off its face to look at the rest of the body, which is why I don't know if it was male or female. My eyes stayed focused on the head. And when my wife flipped the light on, it never looked her way, not even when she started to speak to me. Its head stayed turned in my direction. It was only when I did not answer my wife immediately and she began to walk across the deck to the steps where I was that it moved. And yeah, buddy, it can move. She had come down a single step, and by then it was already gone in the darkness. I remember turning, and suddenly I was able to move, pushing her back up the step. I did not want my wife out there. I don't care if what I had seen wasn't at all aggressive or dangerous seeming. I wasn't chancing it. I did not want my wife out there. Heck, I didn't want to be out there. Even though I knew what it was, I didn't really know about them. I didn't know, should I worry or not? Now, as for my wife, she had seen some movement out in the darkness, but she couldn't have said what it was. But I could, and I did. Once inside, I told her. And I think at first she wasn't sure whether to believe me or not, and not because she doubted me, but because she doubted that they existed. And she really felt sure that I was mistaken. This was a case of mistaken identity. But she felt differently when Daryl and I got together the next afternoon, and we sat right there at the kitchen table talking, and she heard it all from me again. She was shocked that I said outright that I believed it was a Sasquatch, because I told Daryl everything, including what I really thought it was. Now, I did expect that Daryl wouldn't believe me either. But as soon as I said what I thought it was, I was surprised to see that Daryl seemed immediately to be relieved, like he was a balloon that deflated. That's when he told me that he had already seen it too, but from a distance. Now, my wife knew that both of us couldn't be mistaken, and although she didn't want to believe, she did start to believe. Daryl and I decided that we would hopefully be able to remedy this situation ourselves. Since the only thing it seemed to be interested in was water, we were going to put out water every day for it, just inside the trees. We figured that was better than it coming up close to the houses. In the end, Daryl was the only one that was putting out water. He said since it was mostly on his property. I agreed to that because I was happy to keep it away from mine with a young child. And truthfully, I think Daryl was more interested in trying to get another look at it. Now, the few people that I've told since all of this happened said me or Daryl should have waited out there. We should have shot it. We should have done this. We should have done that. We should have. We should have. Whatever. But that wasn't what either me or Daryl wanted to do in this situation. Whether it was a young Sasquatch or not, it was clear to us that it had displayed intelligence, even if it was backed up with some displays of brute force like ripping up the spigot and the piping. But think about it. It knew where the water came from. Sure, maybe it smelled the scent of water at the spigot by the garden, but it still had figured out how to turn that knob. It wasn't quite intelligent enough, however, to know to turn the water back off. And then it showed intelligence when it located the spigot at my house. That's important, because that spigot had not been used in I don't know when. There was no hose hooked up to it, and it was on the side of the house that we never used a spigot for anything. I don't think it had ever been turned on since we moved there. So scent is not what drew it to that spigot. But it had to recognize what it was by its shape, right? It had to know what it was on sight. Because most animals, from my understanding, work more on scent. If it's a visual acuity that they're using, it's usually to hunt moving prey. I don't know about a lot of animals recognizing inanimate objects from a distance. I do know that primates that have been studied have and can do that. And that's what me and Daryl discussed. And that is why we never tried to shoot it, capture it, and we never called anyone about it. It was just a horribly dry and hot summer. That is the only reason that we think it came and did what it did. When the creeks were drying up or were barely just stagnant puddles here and there, this creature had no choice, and we didn't blame it for what it did. And it turned out that Daryl had been leaving it jugs of water without the caps on. But it was still coming after the spigots, first on his house, and then it eventually came to mine. So we reasoned that these creatures may be like cats and a lot of other animals that are known to prefer running water to still water for drinking. I don't know. But we both turned off the outdoor spigots from inside and set jugs of water out, which eventually did begin to disappear. I guess when it wasn't getting anything out of the spigots anymore, it had no choice. We didn't like doing that, but we also couldn't afford to have the water wasted. There were lots of other weird things happening all that summer, but I already think that I've written way too much over the last 3 days that it's taken me to write all this. And there's more that I could say, especially the things that me and Daryl talked and hypothesized about for months. But we no longer live there, and we've rented it out to some family on my wife's side. But I want to make it clear, we did not leave because of the Sasquatch. And no, we didn't see it again after that dry summer. We had to relocate because of job loss. But we do hope to move back there when we retire, because we really do like the area, Sasquatches and all. Please don't use my name. Just call me the Water Boy. It was 1976. I was in the sixth grade, and we went squirrel hunting in the back hills, the hollers of Pinch Run. It was just starting to get a little bit of daylight as I sat down, and my friend that owned the property walked about a mile away from me. I heard something, and I thought it might have been him coming back. I was leaning against a tree, and I could barely make out this huge form, and I thought to myself, "Looks like a tree." But it just stood there. All I could see was a big silhouette, and then all of a sudden, I noticed it had what looked like to be a head on top of it. I was about 30 yards away from it. Then I got the awful smell that kind of stuck and hung in the back of your mouth. I thought it smelled like skunk at first, but then I was like, man, that's bad. Now, back then, we really didn't know about Bigfoot. All I heard were stories from my dad's side of the family. I'm half Native American. I had heard them talking about the hairy man, and I just didn't quite get it. But you've got to realize that my dad was the youngest of 19 siblings, all of them Native Americans, and they had some crazy stories they could tell. Well, back to seeing that big silhouette. I was so scared that even though I had a single-shot 10-gauge shotgun, I didn't even move. It seemed to me like it might have been minutes, but all of a sudden, my buddy came back and said, "You didn't even move. What'd you do, fall asleep?" He looked in my eyes, and then he goes, "Man, what's wrong with you? Your eyes are so big." I didn't say a word to him. We just got up and left. "Nance, I'm sorry, it's not exciting, but I've never told anybody. I'm 57 now, going on 58. You kind of wanted me to share, to let people know that they are out here everywhere, even up close to the Ohio River where I'm at. At that time, I could walk 3 minutes and I could have been right there at the Ohio River. Thank you, Nance. Johnny." "Hi, Nance. Here's my quick little sighting. I was driving home from Atwood Lake on Bark Road. The sun was going down. It was Saturday, July 8th, 2017. I was driving north. We were a couple miles north of the lake, and there were mostly open land on both sides of the road. Me and my girlfriend Mia were both tired, and we were just sitting and talking as we drove. And you guessed it, we saw a Bigfoot cross the road ahead of us. It was just at the far edge of where our headlights were shining on the road. We were doing probably 50 or 55 miles an hour, and even slamming on my brakes, I thought we were going to hit it before the car stopped. But we didn't. It had already cleared to the other side of the road before I was halfway stopped. But I knew what I had seen, and I asked my girlfriend if she had seen it too. She shook her head yes, but didn't speak. We both kept looking over to that side of the road where it had gone. There were no cars behind us, and there were none coming. After a second or so, Mia punches my arm and asks me what I'm waiting for it to come back, and told me to drive and get us out of there. So that's what I did. It was for sure a Bigfoot. Couldn't be anything else. Dark brown, running on two legs, very tall, and covered the road width within a flash. We both saw it, and we both agreed, but we haven't told anyone else before now. Thanks, Ian and Mia. For a couple years, I worked as a maintenance/caretaker of a group of cabins somewhere in the vicinity of the Hocking Hill State Park. The job was okay, but I really disliked both the owner and the manager, and the manager also handled all the reservations, but I needed the job and the money. I got my daily to-dos from the manager, usually anyway. I'll call him Rental Ralph. Now, Rental Ralph didn't know his butt from a hole in the ground, but he was always dressed in L.L. Bean from head to toe, even though he grew up in a very populated city. He couldn't tell a corn snake from a copperhead or a black king snake from a rattlesnake, but he would have made a great snake oil salesman all the same. He was that kind of guy. So other than dealing with Rental Ralph, who I sometimes called Mental Ralph, sorry, Nance, I know I'm getting off topic, but I truly disliked the man at that time. Anyway, other than him, my job was pretty easy most of the time. It was basic maintenance and upkeep and simple repairs. Late August 2008, we started to get reports that somebody was creeping around a couple of our cabins at night. And around the same time, we were getting reports that a raccoon or something was getting into the trash cans that were at the collection points at a particular cabin cluster, and the cans had hooked bungee cords, but somehow the raccoons were getting them off, and nobody could find most of the bungee cords. After a lot of complaints, the owner got us some supposedly bear-proof garbage cans. Then sometime after that, a family left rather abruptly from one of our most remote cabins. They said that there were plumbing issues in the cabin and that the toilet had overflowed several times while they had been there. Now, this was a surprise to all of us, as no one had mentioned anything all summer about any kind of a plumbing issue at that cabin. Personally, I thought that the young toddler of the family had probably shoved something down the toilet. Kids love to do stuff like that, I learned. I went out to the cabin that afternoon to try to fix it. It was, as I said, one of the more remote cabins, and it was one of the cabins that had also recently reported that somebody was creeping around and had also had something getting into the trash. But it was afternoon, not nighttime, so I wasn't thinking about either of those. I got to the cabin, went in, and checked things out. To my surprise, the toilet flushed with no backup or overflow at all. I checked all the taps and the bathtub in case I had misunderstood them, but everything in the house flowed normally. I went back and I told Rental Ralph. He just rolled his eyes and said that he thought they were just trying to get out of paying for the whole week that they had reserved and paid for ahead of time. He said that they told him that they shouldn't have to pay for the rest of their stay, even though they were leaving. I don't know what really how that ended, but the next people at that cabin was a couple. They were older, maybe mid-50s. They had reserved to stay from Friday to Monday morning, but they left after the first night at that cabin. They didn't even come in to check out. They called and told us where they'd left the key, and he said they left because his wife was very ill and they needed to go home so she could see her doctors, and they had left very early that morning. As would happen, we just got a last-minute booking for a family that wanted to arrive Sunday night and was planning to stay till the following Sunday. Rental Ralph put them right in that cabin that the older couple had just vacated. They stayed until Tuesday and left. Definitely a problem there, we thought, but we didn't know what. There were no rentals scheduled for the next several days at that cabin. Since there had been reports of someone creeping around, I went out and checked around. I walked the area around the cabin, and I walked up and down the slope that the cabin sat on. I checked from every angle in and around the cabin. I was looking to see if maybe there was something bad or objectionable that we at the office weren't aware of. I had followed the slope down from the cabin, and I was walking in a natural depression that ran perpendicular to the cabin. I wasn't looking for anything in particular. But then I started to hear a noise, and it was close. And I thought about what it was, and the best I can describe is it was a weird chatter-talk noise. It was up ahead and to my left. I stopped and I looked, but I couldn't see anything but brush from where I stood in the depression. I stopped and listened carefully. I had to be hearing this wrong. It had to be a bird or something. The depression I was in wasn't very deep, so it wasn't like I was hidden from view. It was maybe a foot and a half, maybe 2 feet deep depression from most of the level ground around it. Like maybe it had been a creek a long time ago. But it created a natural funnel for things to walk through, I had noticed, and I figured game like deer had been using it because it looked well used. I called out hello to see if someone was there. No reply. I heard a couple bits more of that warbling chatter talk, then silence. So I yelled out again. It was quiet for a moment. Then I clearly heard some quick chatter, and then it stopped for half a second. Then clear as the day, I heard, "Hello," called back to me from up ahead and on my left. I knew right away what I was hearing was very wrong. It wasn't a person that said it. It was longer and slower than a human would say it. And it didn't make the H sound of the word hello, and the O on the end was pulled out and went up an octave and abruptly ended. The entire voice sounded inhuman and clumsy, like it was just trying to mimic me the way a pet bird would be, but with a really deep voice. It just sounded sinister to me. Now maybe that's what my mind was interpreting as because I was suddenly afraid, but I will say it did not seem friendly in any way. I started to back up. Everything felt very wrong. Every sixth sense that I could possibly have was screaming at me to get out of there. Before I could turn and get out of the depression, I heard another warbling chatter from behind me and to the right. Oh no, more than one. So I had one ahead and one behind. This wasn't good. Then I heard that weird hello again from up ahead. At that moment, I didn't know it was a Bigfoot doing it, but I know now that it was. I found out very shortly. Yes, Bigfoot was either trying to speak to me, or at the very least, he was mimicking me. Now, I didn't make the decision, but my body did, and it bolted back up that slope. I don't even remember doing it. I remember thinking, though, that at any second I was going to be grabbed the whole way up. That's the only memory I have of going back up that slope, expecting to be grabbed at any second. Once I got up to the cabin, I chanced to look back. I was shaking and struggling to breathe. I didn't see anything coming up the slope, but there were trees and brush that started a few feet below the cabin, and they would have provided good cover. And they had. Just as I was sure that it was okay to turn around and go back to my truck, I caught sight of a large black shape looking at me. It was about 60 or 70 feet down the slope and among the trees, but it was large and dark enough that I saw it. I didn't wait. I turned and I ran to my truck. I got in and shut the door. If the window had been down, I would have done a Dukes of Hazzard slide through the window. I was so scared. I was shaking so bad I could barely get the keys out of my pants pocket. I think I screamed and almost hyperventilated in the truck when I saw that it had followed me up the slope. It was now standing to the side of the cabin where the ground started to fall away from the cabin and the deck jutted out from the back. Where I was parked partially faced that side of the cabin, so that was my view.
Checking later against the deck stilts, it was close to 8 feet tall, and like everyone says, it was wide and muscular. Those are just words, though, and they don't do it justice. Out in the open, the fur looked more of a dark brown than the black that it had looked like under the trees down on the slope. I was trying to get the key in the ignition when a good-sized limb landed near the front of my truck. That's when I realized that the second one was somewhere nearby. Now, I had kept my eyes on the one in front of me at the cabin most of the time while trying to put the key in the ignition, so I knew it hadn't thrown that limb. I looked all around, but I couldn't see the second one. Now came a couple clods of dirt. Looked like some plant matter was in them, and it looked like it had pulled up a plant with all the roots and the dirt still clumped on it, and that's what it threw. I don't even know where they were coming from, and I didn't care. I finally got the truck going, and I got out of there. I am trying to remember as much as I can when I'm writing this out, but right now, even still, a lot of this is a big blur. I have no memory of driving back to the office at all. I do know that when I got back, I told Rental Ralph everything. I thought I sounded crazy. I thought I would be fired or at the least laughed at. But weirdly, the guy who doesn't know jack about the outdoors not only took me seriously when I told him what had happened, but he believed me when I told him that I thought there were two Bigfoot out there. He asked me lots of questions over and over, and he called the owner, and now I thought I really was going to get fired. But when the owner came out, he listened to me, and then together we all three went back out to that cabin. I didn't want to go, but they were listening to me, so I thought maybe I wasn't crazy and maybe I could prove it. And I felt better having two more people with me. When we got there, I didn't want to even get out of Ralph's car, and I sure didn't want to go back down that slope. But they did. I waited in the truck, scared to death for them. It seemed like forever until they finally came back. They said they hadn't heard anything, and if they actually saw anything, they didn't say so. But I think they believed me, and I got the feeling none of this was news to the owner. All he cared about was keeping it quiet and not letting word get out. He told Ralph not to rent that cabin or the one closest to it until winter was over again. Like, he knew it would be okay after winter. So Ralph blocked those cabins out for the rest of the year, all the way to March 15th. I don't know what happened after that, because I got out of there and got another job pretty fast. To this day, I can't get the sound of that hello out of my head. Nance, I know what was out there. Rental Ralph agreed. I have since read about the samurai chatter that Bigfoots are supposed to make, and I don't know that that's what I would call it. And I don't even know if chatter is the right word. It was more of a sliding, warbling sound. But I do believe that Bigfoot can mimic when they want to. I don't know if it was trying to communicate, if it was just mimicking without any particular reason the way some birds will do, or if it was trying to lure me closer. I don't know why it followed me back up the slope like it did. I do think it could have caught me at any time if it had really wanted to. But I did get the distinct feeling I was being flushed out. It did not want me down there. After all this time, I still don't know what to think. Was it trying to talk to me? Did I maybe miss a big opportunity? Or did I miss narrowly becoming a missing person? I guess I'll never know, and I'm okay with that. Thanks for listening. Cabin Boy Charlie.
We live on a small offshoot road along Countersport Pike in Pennsylvania. We still live here, so that's all I want to say about where it is. It's a very long road, so I think that's enough to keep us from being known. Now, me and my wife, we don't care so much about ourselves, but we do have children, and one of them has already suffered badly from being bullied. I don't want to add fuel to that fire. Our house sets far back from the access road we're on. We have state game lands, a nature conservancy, and Little Pine State Park all circling where we live. So very thick woods. One night we were watching television and the windows were open. It was May and the kids were sitting up with us. We started to hear screaming out back, and if it had been a human, I would say it sounded like someone was being murdered out there, but none of us thought it was human. We did not sleep with the windows open that night. We heard that scream a few other times. I looked up animals that sound like humans screaming, and I found bobcats, coyotes, foxes, and more. But that more also included Bigfoot. Now, I wasn't even thinking of Bigfoot. I told the family it was probably coyotes, but that was warning enough for them to stay out of the woods. And they did. My wife is a canner, and she grows lots of berries for canning. But one night, something pulled up and ate almost all of her runners of strawberries. Now, that wasn't deer damage. Something had come in and pulled them up and ate the plants completely. Deer don't do that. Then there were nights that we heard not only the screams, but other weird noises from the woods. We did not investigate. There were also nights that a horrible smell would fill the whole house, but it wasn't a skunk and we didn't know what it was. I had not shared with my wife that I thought it might be a Bigfoot, but one night she and my 14-year-old son came home very upset. She said they were driving and then they saw some deer up ahead running across the road, so she slowed down to be sure there weren't any stragglers that were going to run into the road that she might hit. It was near dusk, but not dark enough for headlights yet. She said she watched them all go across the road, and then suddenly my son started yelling at her to look, 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 and he pointed. So she did look where he pointed, and there on the other side of the road, there was a large, hairy, human-like being. She said it was looking right at them in the car. And she said that even in the big car, an SUV, I should say, she did not feel safe. It was so big, she was still worried. So she hit the gas pedal, and they got out of there. As they drove away, my son said he was looking back, and he saw it go across the road. He assumed it was after the deer, and that they had drove along and interrupted his chase. I asked them both what it looked like, and they both agreed that it was over 7 feet tall. The fur was a brown color and wasn't very long-looking. Neither could say what the eye color was, just that the face was leathery on the upper part and the lower part, the jaw area, was all furry. My wife had no idea about the arms or legs. I don't think she ever looked away from its face. But my son had a good look as they drove away, and he said that he saw the very long arms swinging as it walked, and that the legs were very long and muscular. He said that there wasn't much of a neck that he could see in the profile, but it also never looked their way after they drove off. So I told them all the info that I had found on Bigfoot. I told them I hadn't told them because I wasn't sure, and I thought they would think I'm crazy. My son said he definitely would have thought I was crazy if I had told him before that night, but he didn't now. Over the winter, we didn't hear it at all, but of course we weren't out there and the windows were closed. I haven't seen it yet, but there's always the coming summer, right? Thanks a lot, John Doe in Pennsylvania. Dear Buckeye Bigfoot, I would like to remain anonymous. I enjoy your channel, and I decided that after a lot of years to tell my experience with what I saw, and it was a Bigfoot. I swear I saw a Bigfoot. I was in my 30s, later 30s. It was a time in my life where I was very active in deer hunting. The following event took place in the late 1970s. Each year, I saved all of my vacation and personal days, and my job allowed me nearly all of hunting season off from work, and I spent most of it in the woods in an outlaw camp I had built in my early 20s. The log cabin I had built was about 4 miles from any roads. It was on state land deep in the forest and hidden from a nearby brook at around 3,300 feet above sea level. maple, beech, white birch, poplar, black and red spruce, pin oaks, ironwood, and mountain ash were abundant. The cabin had taken me a long time to build, as there were many, many trips carrying heavy boards, roofing material, shovels, rakes, axes, and a tin stove, and all the other things that made it comfortable to live with for extended periods of time. No one knew of the cabin. It was illegal, and I always kept its existence and location a deep secret. It had a small plexiglass window, a food cabinet made of metal to keep the mice out, a hand-built table and chair, a heavy hinged log door, and one bed fashioned from small poplar tree trunks and foam bedding that had to be replaced once a year from the mice using it for their own bedding. Many of the mountains around the camp were over 4,000 feet in elevation. I had brushed out a small trail from behind the cabin to a very steep peak at 3,800 feet. I had named this mountain Pin Oak. I loved climbing this trail by flashlight early in the morning before daylight, as I could slip quietly down the backside to the nosing on the eastern side dotted with several steep ledges where I had a good view at daylight, and I could move silently along the rocks. I had taken several deer over the years on this hunt. It was a difficult drag after the kill, but the area paid off really well with some trophy bucks being harvested. Those times that I hunted Pin Oak, when I had almost reached the top, I would slow down looking all around. Now, if there was no immediate action from local big game, I would take my day pack off and remove my undershirt and outer shirt and spray myself with scent killer and replace those shirts with fresh ones with no sweat. I would pack my sweaty clothes in a plastic bag and stuff them down into my pack and continue on very slowly, not working up any sweat so as to escape detection and carefully creeping across the top of the mountain and down the backside, still hunting at a snail's pace. An old hunter that I learned from when I was very young had told me many years earlier to take a step, stop, and look around before moving again. He had taught me that every step was brand new country, and I had learned to stalk prey very well using this technique. Sometimes it could take 15 minutes just to walk 10 feet. I always called that hunting pace granny gear. One particular morning, I had climbed the trail in search of a buck I had named Hightail It. He got that name because every time I would get close to him, he would smell me, see me, or hear me in some way, sense me being there, and he would hightail it away from me. Deer would bed down around the ledges in cover before daylight so as to be facing the east to catch the warmth from the sunlight as it rose. Now, I had reached the summit of Pin Oak. It was at first light when I noticed the horrible stench of something dead. At first, it was just wafting in the air and would come and go. But within a few minutes, I could smell it constantly. I thought I had come upon a dead bear. Live bears can smell awful, but this smell had to be a dead, rotten bear, or so I initially thought. If it was a bear that had been wounded and died here on Pin Oak, it must have been shot by a low country hunter down in the valley floor area, because I was the only one who hunted above 3,500 to 3,800 feet. I had been hunting here many years and had never seen another hunter or any human tracks anywhere near this height of land. I cautiously stepped over, so slowly, looking from side to side and out in front of me. I even kept an eye behind me, wondering if the bear would come up behind me. Black bears would usually run from the scent of a human. But for a moment, I thought maybe for some strange reason it couldn't catch my scent. This raunchy smell became more and more putrid and intense. I stood quietly and searched in a small semicircle, just moving my head. Then, as an almost uncontrollable chill shot up my back, neck, and arms, I realized I had the powerful sense that I was being watched. Something was watching me. I already had my finger on the safety, ready to quickly release it, and the Browning semi-auto 30-06 was ready for action. I just needed to catch sight of whatever it was and determine if it was a threat. Then I heard a few very low-pitched grunts. I wasn't familiar with this vocalization, but they were close. The animal was perhaps 15 to 20 yards from me. The small pines, about 6 feet in height, and the witch hazel brush kept me from seeing past a few yards. Lots of leaves were still on the scrubby beech whips, too, adding to the trouble I was having seeing in front of me. I hadn't still hunted across the top yet, nor climbed down to the ledges yet, and visibility was hampered by a light misty fog in the morning's dim light. Usually, I would reach the ledges as the fog lifted, and there would be deer movement for the first hour or so of daylight. My heart began to race. What was so near me and grunting? It wasn't like any bear grunt I'd ever heard, and not like any deer sound either. Then I heard a few loud footsteps and the crackling of twigs and rustling of leaves on the ground. I mean loud. I pulled the rifle to my shoulder and waited. My legs were trembling from standing so still for what seemed an eternity. Then, suddenly, I realized the steps were crashing away from me. I reasoned that if I hurried, I would see what it was and perhaps get a shot at a wounded black bear. I did not want to harvest a bear, but I would put a wounded one out of its misery if need be. I had killed 8 bears in these woods over the years and 22 deer. The area was ripe with big game, which is what drew me to these mountains years ago. As I moved hurriedly toward the footsteps, they increased in volume and speed as they quickly headed for the edge of the south-facing ledges. The animal was heading south. I had never seriously hunted in this particular part of the mountaintop, although I had often planned to. I had always made it a practice to hunt easterly toward the rising sun. The grunts turned into a low growl, finishing with a high-pitched vocalization at the end. My chest vibrated from the screech. As I broke out onto a barren rock surface, I just caught a glimpse of a creature in my 3x9 scope. It was bipedal and covered in a dark reddish-brown hair all over it. I would estimate it to stand 7 or 8 feet tall and be 3 or 4 feet or more across the back. It was very muscular. It slipped down a crevice in the rocks, and its arms were long, and it had to weigh 600 or 700 pounds or maybe more. It was huge. It disappeared down the ledges, and I quickly ran over to the face of the outcropping, but it had vanished. I stood there in complete shock, it seemed, for quite a while. I continued to shake and tremble. I was frightened out of my mind. What had I seen? How could something so big vanish so quickly? In the time it took for me to run to the edge of the rock ledge, the creature had completely gone out of sight on a near sheer cliff face. Where could it have gone? I kept asking myself. In a way, it looked human. It had run on 2 legs. When it looked back at me before disappearing over the ledges, it had a flat face with 2 dark eyes, a broad nose, and it looked to have fingers on its hands. They weren't paws like an animal, but hands. Its head didn't have much of a neck, and I couldn't make out whether it had ears. I believed it to be a female, as when it had turned back somewhat to look at me, I noticed it had what looked to be hair-covered breasts. It kind of reminded me of an ape-like creature, but much bigger in size than any ape I had ever seen on TV. I scanned the base of the ledges for quite a while, looking through the scope. I listened carefully, but couldn't hear a sound. I scoped all around, but to no avail. This ordeal was years before any internet, and I had never even heard of Bigfoot or Sasquatch creatures. I had never heard the word cryptid, and I surely didn't believe in ghosts either. I had no idea what I had just witnessed, but I was scared, and I headed back down the trail to camp in a hurry. As I made my way down the steep trail, I wondered what it was and what it could have been doing on the summit. Was it passing through? Was it foraging for food? Did it have young? Could there be a family of these creatures? Was it afraid of me? How long had it observed me? I spent the day in camp wondering whether to cut my vacations short or stick it out. Needless to say, I didn't sleep much that night. Every little creak of the cabin, the snapping of the fire in the wood stove, startled me, and my eyes were wide open and the rifle was leaning against the wall by my bedside. I got up my courage and made a plan throughout the night. On the following morning, I struck out at camp elevation and headed south and worked my way around to the base of those ledges. It was new country to me, as I had stayed away from it for years, as it was so thick with spruce saplings and hemlock blowdown. I worked my way through the slash, being as quiet as I could. When I got to the base of the ledges, I took a rest. I watched from a concealed cover for at least a half hour before moving again and resting at another well-hidden spot under the rock cliffs. I spent the entire day working up and down through those ledges and climbing Pin Oak from the eastern side, but couldn't find a sign of this creature anywhere. I continued to hunt there around Pin Oak and the other surrounding mountains for many years, having spent countless nights in that cabin, and I was never bothered again by this creature. I never saw it again. I never smelled it again. I never spoke of seeing the creature to anyone for fear of ridicule, as my career was in public service. I finally retired, and I've moved to a southern state. But I'll never forget that morning in early November when I swear I saw a Bigfoot. I've enjoyed listening to the stories you relate on your channel and finally decided to tell mine. I have left out the locations and would like to remain anonymous. Thank you. First Encounter, Fall, October, 1980. Hi, Nance. You may share locations, but please, not my name. It was October, 1980, during my senior year in high school. I was 18 years old. On this particular evening, I was at my high school boyfriend's house for dinner with his family, something I did a lot during that time. And as a courtesy to his mother, I always assisted her with cleaning up the kitchen and dishes in exchange as my thank you for allowing me to share their dinner. She was known as a sweet, kind, and gentle lady. Sadly, I can't say my boyfriend's father was known for the same personality. Once dinner was over, he tended to pick at us kids, his wife, and their two family dogs in a rather mean-spirited way. So, as usual, dinner's finished, tormenting begins. To avoid this, I typically took the dog my boyfriend and I claimed as ours for an after-dinner walk. Rudy was a 35 to 40-pound border collie mix. He was a gentle dog, loved everyone, and even tended to put up with the tormenting my boyfriend's dad subjected him to, all in the name of love. For the record, the other dog was a small mixed breed who had long since learned to spend her evenings sleeping, hiding behind the couch. I was and still am an avid animal lover and hated not only that he did this, but was allowed to do this. So, kitchen cleaned and dishwasher loaded, off Rudy and I went for our after-dinner walk. It was early evening, but already dark, very dark. My boyfriend lived in a small housing development nestled deep into the woods of the southern part of Ohio in Fairfield County. The houses were built circling a small lake while facing the lake. The one-way road entering and exiting the village made a complete circle around the lake. At this time, the existing houses were only on each side of the lake, but not on the backside. The road was paved, with the exception of the back of the lake. At that point, the road narrowed into a single dirt lane with the woods almost coming to the edge of each side. Here, the brush was thick, dense, and tall, definitely made the perfect image of a scary scene from a scary movie. As we began our walk, I quickly noticed the dog was acting peculiar. Instead of happily trotting beside me, his long tongue hanging from his mouth, he began to walk slowly on stiff legs, alert and listening. Hackles raised, I suddenly heard a low, throaty growl rumble from somewhere deep inside Rudy's chest, then quickly changing to a whine. Staring intently into the woods from time to time, he would step in front of me, stop, and sit down, as if he were trying to prevent me from going any further. Foolishly, of course, I urged him forward to continue our walk. After all, I was your typical teenager, short on common sense. As soon as I stepped off the freshly paved road, I began hearing something walking beside me in the woods,
where I couldn't see it. I could also tell it was walking on 2 feet. I walked, it walked. I stopped, it stopped. However, it always took one additional step before coming to a halt. I could hear heavy breathing and an occasional grunt. The further I walked into that densely wooded area, every hair on my body felt as if it were standing on end. My common senses were screaming at me to leave, but I was still a bit short on these. Again, my terrified dog froze, standing in front of me, making me stop. Body shaking from nose to tail, he was doing his best to protect me when all he wanted to do was just leave. I was so foolish. However, at that moment, I finally realized Rudy was not only watching our sides, but was also staring straight ahead. Whatever this was beside us, it had a friend, and that friend was in front of us. Were we walking into an ambush? What in the world was going on? It was time to listen to my dog's body language and head for home. After all, his language was screaming practically as loud as his whining, trying to make me understand that we needed to get out of there now. Standing there for another 15 to 20 seconds, I listened to my surroundings, only to realize that it was very quiet. Too quiet. I didn't even hear a frog croaking. Then I heard it, felt it, we both did, a very low, throaty, menacing growl. This time, not from somewhere deep inside of Rudy. I struggled to make sense of what I was hearing. What in the heck is this animal? It has to be an animal. Time to leave. Turning around, we quickly began walking back toward the house. While we were less than 10 minutes away, that now seemed like an eternity. Honestly, I think Rudy and I invented the phrase power walking that night, and even though it would be years before you would officially hear it. Whatever had followed us upon entering the woods now also followed us back out of the woods. While they didn't reveal themselves to us, we knew they were there. Not only did you hear their footsteps, but they definitely breathed very loud and raspy. Reaching the paved road, we broke into a run. Thankfully, both our escorts stayed within the protection of the woods. Had one or both stepped into view, I think I would have died. However, one let out an ear-piercing scream so loud it almost took me to my knees. My legs were like jello. Rudy and I ran the last few feet to the house as fast as we could, meeting my boyfriend and his family on the driveway. They, too, had heard the scream from inside the house. Fearing for our safety, they had dashed from the house. Relief washed over all of us. Me, because I was no longer alone. Them, because they feared for our safety upon hearing that scream. When I told my boyfriend's family what had happened, I never mentioned Bigfoot. I wasn't even thinking about a Bigfoot. Didn't realize that we had them in Ohio. I had an uncle who lived in the state of Idaho, and he did believe in Bigfoot. He spent many hours in the mountains searching constantly for information leading to the identity of Bigfoot. So I had heard plenty of his stories all about Bigfoot. But that's all they were, stories. Something told late at night to scare the bejeebers out of his nieces. My boyfriend's father immediately said it was a bobcat or an escaped juvenile from the juvenile detention center a few miles down the road. During this time, we had a small center, known as Boys Industrial School, or BIS, located in our area. Frequently, boys did escape from there, but I wasn't convinced of this. Those footsteps were really heavy. The growls, not to mention the scream. It just didn't add up to teenage boys having fun. Several years later, and more than 2,000 miles away, I had another situation happen, leading me to believe that night I shared my walk with two Bigfoot. As scary as it sounds, I believe both Rudy and I were walking into an ambush that evening. Fortunately, we escaped. However, I have since learned of many sightings over the years between Fairfield and Hocken County, as well as the entire state of Ohio. Second encounter. Summer. End of June, beginning of July, 1990. During this time of my life, I was living in Kellogg, Idaho, having moved there several years earlier. My husband, our 14-month-old son, and I were currently staying with my uncle and aunt while looking for a place to live. My uncle had multiple mining properties between Idaho, Montana, and Washington. One of his properties in Wallace, Idaho, had a large pole barn on it where he kept a lot of supplies. He had been out there a few days before and said rats had made a nest of the barn. He had a group of investors coming to walk the property, and it really needed cleaned. We offered to clean it for helping us out. After all, they had generously allowed the three of us to stay with them until we could financially get back on our feet. My uncle graciously accepted our offer, taking us to the property to show us what all he needed us to do. A few days later, we loaded our truck with multiple cleaning supplies, our golden retriever, and headed for the property. In order to get there, we drove approximately 20 miles, turned off the main road, and drove through a farmer's field where we came to a shallow but wide creek that we also drove through. Once across the creek, we started up a small incline, but there were several large trees scattered across the entry blocking our path. We were surprised as they weren't there a few days earlier when we went there with my uncle. My husband immediately became angry, asking why my uncle would do something like this, especially since not only were we returning to clean the area, but I was 3 to 4 months pregnant with our second child, and there was no way I could move trees. Luckily, we did have some chains and were able to drag the trees away with the help of our old, faithful truck. This was around July 4th, and my husband took some fireworks with us as well as a .22. A big kid at heart, he planned an evening of fireworks and target shooting after our work was finished. We cleaned the barn and the parking area in front. Once this was done, he planned shooting the rats to try ridding them from the barn. While doing this, I took our old dog to the creek to swim and retrieve sticks. He absolutely lived for water and retrieving. Suddenly, I started being hit with pine cones. Confused where they would be coming from because I was completely in the open, I looked up just in time to see a large tree branch whirling through the sky at me. Sam, my dog, at first was excited, thinking we were starting a new game of fetch. However, he quickly became nervous. Whimpering, he sat by my leg as if asking me to protect him. But now rocks, pine cones, tree branches, and small unearthed trees were landing all around me. Terrified for my life, I quickly ran to the barn for my husband. All he could do was stare at me in disbelief as I told him what had happened. Walking out of the barn towards the truck, he was hit with a small tree branch. Returning to the safety of the barn, we soon realized there was a flat area about 50 feet up the mountainside where these things were coming from. Unfortunately, we couldn't see what was throwing things at us, but whatever it was extremely strong and powerful. We tried running to the truck 3 times, but had to return to the safety of the barn each time. Sobbing hysterically, I really believed we were going to die. While we didn't know what this was, we knew it meant business, and I was terrified. I was a young mom expecting another baby. Yes, I was terrified. My ex gave me the .22, saying to take the dog and get ready to run like hell for the truck. He lit a couple packages of firecrackers, throwing them toward the back of the barn. They exploded, and we ran for the truck. While jumping in the truck, the rocks and trees began rapidly flying in our direction. Sticking the .22 out of my window, I fired a shot off while my husband started rolling the truck down the embankment into the creek. Suddenly, there was a loud bang as our truck lurched forward. Whatever was throwing rocks sure had good aim as it hit our tailgate, caving it in. Furious, my husband began swearing as he had recently restored this 1949 Ford pickup, and now it was damaged. As we crossed the creek, we heard this blood-curdling scream coming from the mountainside. I instantly felt like I was about to vomit. Tears still streaming down my face and body shaking from head to toe, I realized that I'd heard that same scream before, several years ago while walking around the lake in Ohio. Could it be that what happened in both places was the same animal? Upon arriving home, we immediately told my aunt and uncle. Sitting up in their chairs, they both said, "Bigfoot." We told our story to them both, starting with the trees blocking the entrance, which my uncle denied doing, to the caved-in tailgate on our truck. They repeatedly said, "This was a Bigfoot attack." A few days later, my uncle showed us some castings of Bigfoot prints that he had found on the property, but reassured us that he had never experienced anything hostile while out there, and he was there a lot. After a few hours of begging, my uncle convinced us to return to the property with him and a large group of armed men to see what they might find. Boy, was it a mess. The parking area was once again blocked with the trees we had previously moved. The area between the mountainside and the barn was littered with trees, branches, large rocks, and pine cones. The most terrifying thing was the barn was not only riddled with large, fist-sized holes, but the main door was completely ripped from the barn and nowhere to be found. According to my uncle, they never did find that door. The inside of the barn was a disaster. The boxes of core samples and reports were shredded worse than any rat could ever do. And the rats my husband had shot, he had thrown them into a pile at the back of the barn. They were no longer there. Not any sign of them. No blood, remains, nothing. Whatever took them literally picked them up and walked away. The men climbed up the mountainside to the flat area where we had said the things thrown at us came from. Again, debris was scattered everywhere, but what scared me the most was the men measured how high up the tree the branches were before they were torn off. The average height was 18 to 22 feet. It's been many years since these terrifying situations happened, but looking back, I firmly believe that both encounters were related to Bigfoot, and I honestly feel that I was on their menu. I really haven't spent time in the woods since. I kept my story to myself until about 5 or 6 years ago, fearing ridicule. As it happens, the few people, some family, that I've shared my story with have had their fun at my expense. While I cannot say for sure these are Bigfoot encounters, I can't think of what else they could be. So at this time, I'm choosing to believe, as I honestly feel I crossed paths with Bigfoot twice now, once in Ohio and again in Idaho. Thanks for allowing me to tell my story where I won't be ridiculed. I live in Vinton County. We have woods, and there are four-wheeler quad trails out there. We have two dogs, both mixed breeds. We think Tilly, the husky mix, is about 6 years old. We don't know what Scooter is, but he's smaller than Tilly, and the vet said probably about 4 years old. When it's not bad out, I take the four-wheeler out along the trails, and the dogs like to run with me, usually ahead of me. So that's what we were doing this day when all of a sudden the dog stopped up ahead. So I slow down, and then suddenly Scooter comes running back at me and then past me. Tilly's just up there barking. I was thinking a coyote or something up there. So I get up to where Tilly is, and now I see the ruff on the back of her neck is raised. I'm thinking, again, maybe a coyote or a black bear, but it was something. So I go up a bit more, get the four-wheeler turned around, and then I try to get Tilly to get on the back of the four-wheeler, which she used to do all the time, but she wouldn't do it. So now I'm getting worried. I'm thinking whatever it is really close. I didn't go out there armed. I never do. I've never needed to. I just have a couple acres, and I've never ran into a predator out there during the day or at night. And besides, every animal usually runs when they hear that four-wheeler. So I'm scanning the area, and that's when I see it. It's just hanging back away from the trail, just watching. It stood off to the side of several trees. Now my hackles were raised. Big, hairy, wide face, eyes set far apart. Although I was sitting down, I'd put the height at over 6 feet. It didn't seem as wide and well-built as I thought a Bigfoot would be, but it was enough to scare me. The color was black. I grabbed Tilly and I put her on the four-wheeler in front of me. She's shaking. We take off down the trail as fast as I could. Scooter was already at the house and my wife was getting on the other quad to come look for me. She got scared and thought something had happened because Scooter came back alone and he had never done that. I told her what I saw. We put the dogs in the house, then I got a shotgun and we took the quads back out to look around that area. I didn't want to find it or shoot it, but we both just kind of wanted to look around. Maybe we thought we would see some tracks, but we didn't find anything at all. I waited until the dogs wanted to go running again before we went back out on the trails, but that was a few days away after this happened. And that ain't a lot to tell, but it's what I have. Thanks, Mr. Miller. Years ago, I dated a guy whose family lived near Cross Creek up in Jefferson County. This was a couple years after the whole Minerva thing in the news, but that was far from where they were. There were all kinds of things that my boyfriend said went on there, not all Bigfoot related, and I didn't know what to believe. But then I saw things when I was there, and I did believe. One summer, we spent a lot of time there with his parents. Once I saw what looked like prints down along that creek, and no, I don't think it was a setup. We went out walking on a spur of the moment, and I was the one picking the direction. I didn't have anything to measure the prints with, and there were no cell phones back then. Right away, he started pushing me to back away from the creek, and he said it wasn't okay to be there now. I thought there was some person who was barefoot and sliding around in the mud, so I didn't know why he was acting that way. Then there were lots of nights we heard weird calls out in the woods. We heard wood sounds, too, but I didn't know what those were then. He kept saying it was another monster like Minerva. Now, I thought he was just trying to scare me. But then his parents said the same thing, and they really believed it. So I asked them, "Why didn't you call someone?" And all they said was, "Who are we going to call? The newspapers? You saw how well that worked out for the people in Minerva, didn't you?" I wasn't sure at that time how it had worked out for them, but now I know, and now I get it. Now I know why they didn't call anyone. But that day, the one that we saw it, we were just walking down the train tracks that ran by the creek. That was an easy way for us to walk to one of his friend's houses, just follow those tracks, and it was safer than walking or biking on that road. Now, I don't know what the distance was, but it was pretty far away from us when we saw it. There was this big, black-looking creature walking on 2 feet, and it came out of the trees on one side of the tracks, crossed over, and walked along following the tracks for maybe 8 or 10 seconds. Then it went into the trees on that side, like it was looking for a particular spot before it went into the trees. We didn't hang around there, and we got out immediately. We went back to his parents, and we didn't walk those tracks again. I do believe it was a Bigfoot. What else could it be? It was really tall, and even from that distance, I could tell that. I can't tell you any more because it was so far away, but I just wanted to say what I saw. Thanks a lot, Dawn.